so you don't see it appear.
You have no idea what you're looking at. Do you know who that is?
Frankenstein factories where they create alien looking.
There's no question about it.
Welcome back to the channel, everybody. Here we go.
I grab the lemon and I touch it and I'm like, why is it not cut in half? In my face, I'm like, what the fuck?
Behind it, didn't it? Holy shit.
That's bugs.
Holy shit.
I'm not gonna lie, I was kinda scared then.
This right here is another reason why I would rather stay on land.
Like what a condition one in Antarctica is really like. Check this out. This is the entryway to our dorm. Normally this has carpet on the ground and the walls are just normally walls, you know. But we're going to open the door right now. It's a little bit like opening up the door to another world. Are you ready? Yeah. It's a little bit blowy out there right now.
Three, two, one.
Nope.
Oh shit.
Dude! I'm okay, but I need help! I need a helicopter!
3.
Frankenstein factories where they create alien looking.
There's no
beings.
Question about it. I had a friend that worked up at the test site who went to work in the 80s, the early 80s, late 70s and early 80s, over in Saudi Arabia. We sat down in the early 80s at the, my house over on the other side of town. There was kind of a lull in the conversation. He says, John, what do you know about cloning? And I said, nothing. I mean, this was so far out to me. And he said, just let me tell you, it's all real and it's all happening. And this is from Cecil McMains, a guy who's so down to earth, who worked on the SR-71, who did a lot of stuff, you know. And he would never, ever come out with something so unusual.
He said in level 5, he'd walk on by and people would be in cages and screaming and begging for help, and he was told to,
I heard that.
To walk straight on through and not look or pay attention.
Yeah.
These people are all mad.
I heard that.
So there, it really is a Frankenstein factory.
As you may know, cloning has been around decades ago. Just imagine the advances that the cloning technology has nowadays. And they make it seem like the technology isn't here yet. Should also make you reconsider putting your towels inside your bathroom. And just imagine putting dirty water on your face.
Various cultures have tales of trees being sacred and spiritual.
Right, Daisy and Deacon, make the noise, see if the tree will talk to you.
Shh.
Did you hear that? Right, say it again, see if it'll talk to you again. Right, shh. Did you hear that?
Yeah, I think it's a tree herder.
It's a tree herder?
Yeah.
He's doing it again. Make a noise, Daisy, see if it'll talk to you.
A man went into the forest with his two little daughters when something extraordinary happened. He asked them to speak to the trees, and every time they did, they would get a response. In Norse mythology, there is a tree called Yggdrasil, a sacred link to many worlds. Greeks also tell tales of nymphs called dryads that live in trees. Could that be the case here? Could the response they heard from the trees be from another dimension or a tree nymph? While I want to believe so, the responses sound a lot like branches swaying in the wind. I would have said an old door creaking if they weren't in the woods, but perhaps that's just the skeptic in me. What do you guys think?
Right. Daisy and Deacon, make the noise, see if the tree will talk to you. Did you hear that? Right, say it again, see if it'll talk to you again. Right, shh. Did you hear that?
Yeah, I think it's a tree herder.
It's a tree herder?
Yeah.
He's doing it again. Make a noise, Daisy, see if it'll talk to you. It did. Do it again.
If it's the wind causing the creaking sound, then how come it's only affecting one tree?
Okay, now before I show y'all this video, I need to let y'all know that it's in Creole, and I found it from this other creator, but it was just crazy how it was there, and I had to share it with you guys. I'm gonna try the best that I could to translate what they're saying in the video. I tried to find the video alone, but I couldn't. So I'm just gonna show y'all, you know, with the other person that did the video. All right, so you can see it up here. His thing right now is to steal the soul of somebody's newborn baby. Y'all know how I be telling y'all about newborn babies, to protect y'all newborn babies. There he goes. He's walking backwards. And this is Haiti. Like, this house is in Haiti. Disappeared. Mind you, security systems are starting to be new in Haiti right now, so I bet he didn't expect to be caught on camera. And you'll see him reappear with the baby in his hand. This was the 14th of November in 2021. Yep, there he is. Yep. He has the baby. He currently has the baby right now. Yep, and he's walking back. Backwards. If you know, you know. He's gonna put the baby right next to that thing he flew in into. Why do y'all think, I be telling y'all, the brooms and stuff like that that y'all see in movies, they come from somewhere. Look, he puts the baby down, and he's gonna start doing his ritual. He started, yep, he started. Y'all see that? Yep, there you go. It's funny because he kind of looks like he's crib walking, but it's all part of the ritual. And the guy talking, he's saying, in the morning, you're going to see that your baby's sick and you don't know what's wrong with your baby. Whole time, this is what happened the night before. And the thing is, that baby is still next to that mom right now. There you go. He's doing all his rituals. You see that? You see that? Yep. Once he's done with his ritual, he's going to return the baby. He's walking backwards yet again. He's walking backwards. And he'll disappear again. You can't make this up, bro. Boom, he's about to come. He's gonna walk backwards again. Look, he's gonna disappear. He's gonna finish his ritual, do his dance. He or she.
Even here in the Philippines, there are various tribes who perform rituals, ceremonies like this. Not a lot of people know that.
Look at that. Looking down, it's not even in the same direction. Like it's floating. There it is. Let me, hold on. This camera's gotta straighten itself out. Hold on. Let me do this right. All right, here we go. Here we go. And here we go. This is the moon. This is not an app. I've been waiting for you. Oh, big face in the sky. Yeah, see it? You can't see it with the naked eye unless you zoom in, and it's something about the light. Hold on. There you go. Check it. Check it out. There it is. Beautiful. Scary at the same time. It's back. Look at that. Now look at that. See this? Couldn't see it at first with my naked eye because I'm trying to look at the moon and the camera at the same time. But check that out. Look at that. Looking down. It's not even in the same direction. Like it's floating. There it is. Take that to the banks. Take that to the banks. It's the face. Oh my, oh my. You better get right. Get right.
Did you see it? How come these things seem to only happen in America?
Hey, if you're still here, please do me a favor and give the video a thumbs up. I make videos like this every day and I would greatly appreciate it if you can join me again tomorrow. Thanks.
You have no idea what you're looking at. Do you know who that is? If you've seen this statue before or you believe you know who this statue is, go in the comments and write it below right now. This video is going to be very quick, so make sure you're listening because this information is going to be coming to you fast. There are a lot of ancient cultures that tell a story. This story normally invokes a high god or many high gods, and they normally live beside humans. And they take care of humans, and they love the humans, and they have a good relationship with the humans. But the humans normally do something that's not so good. I mean, the gods have given them everything at this point. They've given them the earth, they've given them fruit, they've given them food. These humans live in abundance. They live off of the earth, one with nature. But in all these stories, again, look at Greek mythology, look at Hebrew mythology. In all these stories, the humans betray the gods. They lose trust in them. And instead invoke trust in the spirit of man. So the most high god or the king of the god, whoever's at the top, in most of these stories, they normally get upset and they push them out and say, fine, do what you want to do. And then normally that most high deity disappears. He leaves in disappointment of his creation. I don't know if you know, but ancient humans, hunter-gatherers, used to go around not only hunting and gathering, but they used to be able to perform surgery on one another. They don't teach you that, huh? They used to create very complex homes, some underground, some above ground. They used to literally go around planting forests, spreading the beauty of the earth. I mean, the entire Amazon rainforest is created by ancient hunter-gatherers, or at least most of it. You actually find that most of these gods do not like civilization. If you've been watching my channel, then you know why. I'm not going to get into it right now because I know you want to know who this is. This is El. A Near Eastern god. Not just any god. He is the most high god. El Elyon in the Bible is what he's called. He has children. He has Baal. He has Anat. One of his children, many of you don't know, is his children. And it is Yahweh. That's going to really bother a lot of people because they believe Yahweh is the most high god. But contrary to popular belief, Yahweh achieved this title. He didn't originally have this title. There's a new book coming out called World War Gods, where it really goes through this abstract history of spirits and deities fighting for this power and really show you what type of god Yahweh was and what type of god Yahweh became. But until that book comes out, there's another book called FAMS, Food, Forest, Foraging, Hunting, Anti-Fragile Modern Society. This book breaks down the Adam and Eve story, how the world already ended, hunter-gatherer, everything you really need to know, honestly, about this world that we live in. The audio version is free and it's in the link at the top of my page. You don't believe me that El is not the same as Yahweh, and El is the father of Yahweh, then you need to go and read the Dead Sea Scrolls, which has some of the oldest texts from the Bible before the Hebrews changed the Bible. And it states in there, I believe in Deuteronomy, that Yahweh was not only just one of the children of El, but that El gave him a portion of humanity called Yaqub or Jacob. I love you all. Peace.
It turns out that the ancient generals weren't lying at all, and they really could accomplish 100 kills. This authentic image taken in 1924 documents what the king's armor of Europe really looks like, with 360-degree protection that even modern body armor can't do. With a slight nod of the wearer's head, we can see the armor encasing the entire head, completely sealed except for the small holes reserved for the eye area. The scale treatment at the neck allows the head to move at will. In terms of arm making, the armor is designed with scales and the joints are sewn together with small iron pieces so that even if the arms are fully 90-degree, the body will not feel any discomfort. When the camera pans down, we can see that the armor protects even the palms of the hands. When the wearer holds a weapon in his hand, he only needs to fasten the iron skin behind his hand, and the whole palm will be wrapped in iron. In addition to the outer layer of iron, the armor inside there is a layer of wire underwear. This iron armor is finely crafted and can cushion damage from heavy blows such as hammers. When the camera goes down later, we can see that the armor leg design still uses a scale finish, and the legs can flex and bend. I thought that this was a sign of European blacksmithing, but after seeing the armor's shoes, I was truly shocked. The entire shoe is all sewn together with iron pieces and can not only twist up and down, but also sway from side to side. So that means the shoes can navigate any terrain. After seeing the European king's armor, I began to believe that the ancient generals weren't lying and that they were really capable of accomplishing 100 kills.
It's probably way too heavy. It's difficult to move around. Plus, electricity might just be one of its greatest weaknesses. What do you think?
This is a buoyancy-driven water wheel, based on Archimedes' principle of buoyancy. It features 9 specially shaped floats evenly fixed to the water wheel. When water is added, the floats move, creating greater torque on the right side and causing rotation. When several rollers are placed into a disc and divided into 4 sections, gravity can also drive the disc to rotate. However, according to the laws of thermodynamics, no self-rotating device can become a perpetual motion machine. This is because the law of conservation of energy states that energy can neither be created nor destroyed. Attempting to continuously perform work without consuming energy is unrealistic. Moreover, any mechanical system experiences friction, which leads to energy loss and wear and tear on the machine. Given that the concept of a perpetual motion machine is unscientific, investing a lot of time, effort, and resources into researching an impossible device is impractical. It is more beneficial to focus on achievable and useful technologies. Therefore, many places have banned the study of perpetual motion machines.
Bring American capital and expertise and standards to Africa so that we can keep exploiting, so that we can exploring where we can get these minerals.
See the regret on his face right after he realized what he said? Knows he's in trouble after that.
He created his own medicine in a desperate attempt to treat his son's fatal disease, despite having zero experience in chemistry. Chu Wei's son has Mankes syndrome, a rare fatal disorder, and only has a few months to live. Chu learned one medicine did exist that could extend his son's life, but it wasn't available in China. So with only a high school degree, he created his own lab in his father's apartment, determined to recreate that medicine. He knew the chances were slim, but said he doesn't want his son to wait for death in despair. Even if it fails, I want my son to be on the path of pursuing hope. But the clock was ticking, as most kids with this disease don't make it past 3 years old. He spent many sleepless nights researching everything he possibly could, and in just 6 weeks, he had his first vial. He tested it on himself before eventually giving small amounts to his child. And it worked. Blood tests showed his son's copper levels returned to normal 2 weeks into the treatment. And 2 years later, his son is still alive. Now, Xu has become a full-time chemist and is working with an international biotech lab to help launch gene therapy research into Mankes syndrome.
If it's in any other place, that person could be in jail now. Alright guys, that's it for today's session. I will be ending the video with the next clip. Please let me know what you like or dislike about this video. And don't forget to subscribe if you haven't already. Thanks again everyone for showing up, and I will see you around.
British place names can be tricky to pronounce.
Take this place. Looks simple. But what if we told you it was pronounced Grimmies?
We'd be lying. It's Grimsby.
But other places can be genuinely fiddly for foreigners.
And tourists who get it wrong risk being imprisoned or killed.
In today's programme, we're going to ask why British place names are so hard to pronounce.
Is there an and coming?
No, I'm done.
Welcome to Map Men.
We're the men.
And here's the map.
Map Men, Map Men, Map, 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 Map Men, Men.
There are difficult to pronounce place names all over the world.
California has Zizix, Slovenia has Ptuj, Greenland has
Kekker Tarsuid Shot.
Even Welsh natives struggle with this one.
And tonight we can expect to see heavy showers spreading from the west into Wales.
But deliberately hard to pronounce names invented for promotional purposes like Llanfai, Pwchgwyn, Gwchgogera, Chwindrobochlantisil, Gogogoch aside,
show off.
British place names cause more trouble than most, because they often look straightforward but contain nonsensical phonetic traps that are impossible to predict.
Try this one.
Go on, say it out loud, in your room or on your train.
Ha! 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 Wrong, it's not Frome.
F-R-O-M-E, it should be blitheringly obvious, is pronounced Froome.
But if you did say Frome, don't worry, you're in good company. Froome is officially the most mispronounced place name in Britain, and that's according to a proper survey.
Excuse me, could you mispronounce Froome for me?
Portsmouth.
That'll do. There's nothing more fun than laughing at tourists who don't know how to say something properly simply because they're from a different country and could never reasonably be expected to have predicted a local pronunciation that contradicts the basic rules of language.
So, we've created the perfect travel agent's itinerary for maximising tourist humiliation across the country.
Starting in Beaulieu,
Beauly,
head over to Rampisham,
Ransom,
then down to Mousehole,
Mousel,
next travel north up to Towcester,
Toaster,
then a quick jaunt to Gotham,
Gotham,
followed by a stop in Quernmore,
Quarmer,
before finishing up in Alnwick,
Alnwick, which is near Newcastle,
or as the people from the city itself say, Newcastle.
When will they learn? As you can hear, no letter of the English alphabet is safe from being pronounced any of dozens of different ways.
Including not at all.
Thankfully, there are some general rules you can stick to, and because we're nice, we'll help the un-British amongst you through a couple of basics.
Sester is pronounced Stir.
Leicester, Worcester, Gloucester.
W at the start of the final syllable is silent.
Norwich, Berwick, Southwark.
ER is pronounced R.
Berkshire, Clerkenwell, Hertfordshire.
But before you get too reassured, for every rule in the English language there are always exceptions, such as the Sester in
Cirencester,
the W in
Sandwich,
and the sound in
This is disgusting. Oh, sorry, Berkhamsted.
Which is in Hertfordshire.
The only way to be absolutely sure of pronouncing British place names correctly is to live here long enough to learn every single one of them, one at a time. Sorry.
So, who were the complete anchors that invented these rules?
It's time for an English lesson.
To make an English language, you start with the base of Germanic Anglo-Saxon. Mix in a healthy dash of Old Norse, a huge dollop of Norman French, and just a barely detectable hint of Celtic. Trust me, it'll make all the difference. Stir it up for hundreds of years until the vowels really start to shift, and then... English.
Excitingly, by looking at a map of Britain today, we can clearly see which invaders influenced our language where by plotting the origins of British place names. This marvellous, messy, multicoloured map shows which languages different British place names belong to and is a living history of our early settlers and subsequent invaders.
The oldest place names here are of Celtic origin. This is where you'll find all the place names with words like Tre, Loch, Bryn and Aber.
Such as Aberystwyth, meaning the mouth, Aber, of the river Ystwyth.
Which coincidentally is exactly where we find Aberystwyth today.
Celtic languages were once spoken all across the British Isles, but are now reduced to a small minority of mountain dwellers. And that's because low-lying Middle England Brits turned out to be more worse at resisting invading armies.
First up were the Romans, who brought in Britain's Latin influences.
Like the rumba?
No, like boring Latin. Hmm. Anywhere that ends in Caster, Cester, Chester or Xeter was a Roman fort, from the Latin word castra, meaning Roman fort.
But the Romans didn't stay long, so although their naming system was long-lasting, the actual names they used weren't, which is perhaps unsurprising when we learn they used names like Castra Exploratorum and Belgic Oppidum,
which were sensibly renamed Braintree.
Next, in light pink, we have the biggest group, Germanic Anglo-Saxon.
Any place containing the words Ham, Hurst, Lee, Berry, Ford, Port, Mere, Stead, Tun, Stow, Wick, Witch or Mere are of good old Anglo-Saxon origin and massively dominate southern England.
Like Buckingham.
or a low-lying area of land belonging to an Anglo-Saxon called Bucker. Perhaps the most upheavaling thing to happen to Britain's place names was the Vikings, who swept in from Scandinavia in the 9th century, committing brutal crimes including rape, pillage, and the renaming of small to medium-sized settlements. You can tell a place was named by the Vikings if it ends in Thwaite, Thorpe, Kirk, or B, such as our old friend Grimsby. Named after an important Viking called Grim, famed for his infectious positive energy, Grimsby literally means Grim's village.
Really?
We're all familiar with these common settlement suffixes, but what's so striking is how clearly this map of Viking place names reflects the extent of the Viking invasions. You can practically see the exact location of the Danelaw dividing Viking and Anglo-Saxon England without needing to draw it on with thick red pen. Following all these invasions, Britain was littered with place names that originated in different languages and accents. But the final thing that would make its place names truly unpronounceable was time. Over hundreds of years, locals who were too busy to pronounce all the syllables in Cester reduced it to Stir to save time. But they couldn't read or write, so the spelling stayed the same. And while the English language has continued to gradually evolve, our place names haven't, resulting in a language landscape littered with phonetic booby traps. But what about Froome? Which linguistic group is responsible for Britain's so-called hardest place name? Unusually for a place name in England, Froome is from a surviving Celtic word, Frama, which means fair, fine or brisk, probably describing the flow of its lovely river. It's not really surprising that the oldest language in these islands is the one that's drifted the furthest from pronounceability. So don't forget to join us for the next episode of Map Men. Is that the end of your sentence?
Yeah, I'm done.